And our first speaker will be Dennis Dix. Let me just, for the record, say that I think none of the major philosophers who contributed substantially to the issue of time and temporality, I think, has ever seriously held the A-series view of time, which involves the successive coming into existence of layers of now. I mean, none of the big guys there, Aristotle, Kant, not even Bergson and Husserl ever suggested that you could capture the essence of time or the form of time in the linear series of nows. So just for the record, but that's the philosopher's contribution.
That's the content of my talk.
Okay, so Dennis, you're first.
Thank you.
Well,
Well, first of all, a word of thanks to the organizers for organizing this conference in a historic place. I knew of the place because of the names of Jörg and Dick and many others, but never been there, so it's an honor to be attending here in this conference. And as you said, today is the first day that all those philosophers who have been mentioned but never identified as such will be able to speak. So I dare to say that I'm a philosopher and I'm willing to take the attack from the physicists. Although I have a background in physics, so I studied theoretical physics and then went into the philosophy of physics. So I'm not completely innocent as far as the physics is concerned. So, and then, as you already explained, I was asked to speak about time and also to set the stage a little bit for a discussion between, I would say the dominant point of view in the philosophy of time, which I will present here, and a somewhat different point of view that will be presented by Yuval Dolev, who should be somewhere, who is there. So, what am I going to do? First of all, I got several questions about the gentleman in the top right corner. Do you know who that is?
William James.
Yes. So that makes the distinction between the physicists and the philosophers. Well, I suppose everybody knows who this is, but then it's given away by what's written here. But this is William James, an American philosopher and psychologist who introduced important concepts for the topic, and I will come back to that. So this is an overview of what I will be doing. So first, I will say something about the typicalities, characteristics of experiential time. Then I will compare that with time in classical physics and relativity. Well, I will focus on relativity theory, but I mentioned the classical mechanics. And then my main message is, and I'm going to reveal it already now, that time as used in physics is more fundamental than time as we directly experience it in intuition. And there are several arguments for that, but one of the most important arguments is that time as we experience it has certain additional characteristics compared to physical time, but we don't need these additional characteristics when we give explanations. So they are explanatorily superfluous. So that will be an important argument. And then, because this is a conference on quantum gravity, I felt obliged to also add something about about time in the quantum gravity. And I think there are good reasons actually for doing so, apart from what I just said, because there are new aspects in the context of quantum gravity. And I think in the context of quantum gravity, we for the first time meet a situation in which it's justified to say that time perhaps, it might not exist, but it's an obscure and unclear situation. But I would say, also anticipating the arguments, that before quantum gravity, there is no question, especially from a physical point of view, about the issue of whether or not time exists. Time does exist, but not exactly in the way we experience it. Well, that will be more or less my conclusion. So what are the characteristics of time as we feel it? Well, there are several things here. First of all, we all have this idea that we are in one common, well, slice of time in now. We make contact with each other in the same now. And as will become clear in a moment, that's a very deceptive notion, but still it has some power on you. And I remember vividly, and I was still, I think I was still in primary school, the upper classes, when I first realized or was told that actually when you make contact with someone else, that someone else is in the past compared to you. And that seems so counterintuitive, but of course in the course of time you get used to that idea. But in direct experience, there is this notion that we share a well-defined present and now. And now one very important point comes up. This already was mentioned a little bit in the introduction. There is this feeling that this now doesn't remain the same. It shifts all the time. And we cannot resist this flow, this stream of time. We've taken along with it. It's like a river on which we are little boats and taken along. And so we drift on this river. And that, in the philosophy of time, I'm not quite sure whether there are no philosophers who take this seriously, actually. Tim Maudlin is one who thinks along these lines. Well,
I said major of yours.
Oh, wow. Well, that's not this. So another characteristic is that this now, so that's a preferred point on the timeline, makes a distinction also in an ontological sense. What I mean by that is that it makes a distinction concerning the status of being. Things on one side of the now have a different mode of being than events on the other side. And well, there are different opinions about that. So some people think that only the present, so this common present with this global extent of space, only that present is real. Only that exists. That's called presentism. And some people go as far as saying that that means that even the past does not exist. So that's a real pure presentism. Only the present exists, past doesn't exist, future doesn't exist. And then there are milder forms which say something like the present exists and also the past exists, but the future does not exist at all. And there are variations on that. So, well, I'll come back to a number of these things in a moment. And these distinctions are reflected in the way we use language. And the grammatical term to be used here is the tenses of language. So at least in Western languages, we conjugate the verbs, and we have a past tense, future tense, and a present tense. And that has to do with this distinction between the ontological status of past, present, and future. And in the philosophical discussions surrounding this subject, a distinction is made, and I will also come back to this, to tenseless accounts of time. So that's without the idea that there are these distinctions, and tensed accounts of time, in which you make these distinctions that I allude to here. Now I must make a number of remarks. The first one is that very often when you discuss these things with physicists, there is a confusion, and people think that when philosophers speak about the flow of time, that what actually is at stake is an asymmetry in time. And so they say, oh, it's just a matter of entropy. Entropy was low in the past, it will be high in the future. But we should make a sharp distinction between flow, which involves motion, and asymmetry. So a mathematical function can be asymmetric. So suppose you have some function on the x-axis and it's very small on the left-hand side, so for negative values of x, it's very high on the right-hand side, then it's asymmetrical, of course. But there's no notion of flow involved, so there's no pivot point on the x axis. And even if there were such a point, it would not be flowing and moving. So there's a conceptual distinction between an asymmetry and motion. And then a second point that I should note immediately is that if you're going to think about these intuitions, so this flow of time, then immediately you're presented with some conceptual difficulties. So, for instance, when you ask how fast does time flow, well, then you get, well what would you suggest? It must be something like 1 second per second. And that seems to be a not very informative answer. So there's a problem with that. And the notion of flow or motion in itself. So when we usually speak about motion, then what we mean is that there are different positions at different times. But when we speak about motion of time itself, that seems to reduce to, I mean, that definition of motion, that seems to reduce to nothing. That at different times, time is at a different position. Yeah, well, that seems to lead nowhere. So there are certain difficulties here that become clear as soon as you really start to take these everyday notions seriously, and then you're going to think of it. And actually, that's the background of the first philosopher that I would mention in this context. I think the first person who very seriously stated in the history of Western philosophy, the first person who's really taken seriously on this point, so who stated that time does not exist. And he gave an argument, so that's MacTaggart, a British philosopher.
You don't count Parmenides.
Sorry?
Parmenides.
No, well, so he Parmenides. MacTaggart certainly was not the first one to make suggestions in that direction, but I think he's scared it with the idea, well, with a real sustained argument. And Parmenides, well, in the ancient Greek philosophers, you know, they only have some fragments of text, and then it's not so clear how to interpret these things. So change, yes, change or something, yeah. Okay, so I'm going to focus on MacTaggart. And so MacTaggart made the distinction that already was mentioned in the introduction between two concepts of time, the A series of time, which is time as known from intuition, time that's flowing. So there's a preferred now there, and goes so on. And the B series, and this B series, well, think of it as B being an abbreviation of block. So you just have moments, and they have relations with respect to each other. So one instant, one moment of time is earlier than another. So you have to earlier later relation, but there's no preferred time on the axis, and so there's no flow. And what MacTaggart argues, and it's more or less in the vein of the arguments already gave on the previous slide, that the A series is not really consistent, so that's the conception in which time is long, is not really consistent, and the argument is very simple. According to this A series, with the flowing now, one and the same event, me standing here now, can be past, present, and future. First it was future, then it becomes present, and then it becomes past. It already is past now, I mean what I just said. But think about it, it's all about the same event. So at a particular spatial position, and a particular date, particular indication of the watch. And so how can the same event be, well, both past and present and also be future? So that's contradictory. And on the basis of that, MacTaggart concluded that, well, that cannot be. Now there are ways to circumvent, to avoid that conclusion. And actually, MacTaggart's article is rather long, and he discusses possible objections. And because of this long discussion and the long character, the complicated nature of his article, even today there is discussion about, and it's controversial whether the argument is valid or not. I myself would say it's actually valid, but that's controversial. But let's look at the conclusion McTaggart draws. What he says is, well, I've shown that this A series with the moving now is contradictory, inconsistent. On the other hand, time without this flowing now is not time at all. Then it would be indistinguishable from space. And so what I have shown, McTaggart concludes, is that time does not exist. So I think this is, so forget about the ancients, but I think in modern philosophy, I think this is the first real argument for the non-existence of time. And something that you hear a lot about, I mean, this non-existence of time in present-day discussions about quantum gravity. You have a question about this?
The proof is based on the notion of same event.
Same event, yes.
And then what means same event? It's not here.
Well,
yes.
Oh. Well, I'm not sure whether I understand your doubt on this point. For me, it's clear what the same event is. It's just one event, me standing here now, at a particular position, at a particular time. And that very same event can get the predicate being past, as it already now is, being present, and I state it, and I got it.
If you include the predicate.
So that's exactly what McTaggart does. So he considers objections and he says, well, this assignment of past, present, and future to that event, that happens at different times. But then the argument repeats itself. Then we ask the same thing.
If you assume that it's the same event, then that means that time doesn't exist. So you suppose that...
No, I don't think so. Well, let's reserve this for later discussion, because I'm going to consider the block universe and that we have all these events.
Yeah, 1908.
This is 1908, so in blissful ignorance of Einstein and...
No, except in Minkowski famously.
Yeah, but so...
No, at all.
So, but McTaggart is a philosopher.
No, but did he know, was it after September 1908, year 1808?
I'm not quite sure. So this is an article in Mind, I think, and so it must have been submitted and written earlier, and so there are good chances that it was before Minkowski's lecture, but I don't think it's important at all, because McTaggart was in a completely different circle. So he's a British philosopher, but he was an Hegel scholar, so German idealism. So normally you think of all these British philosophers as people in the analytical tradition, but you will be surprised that there are many German idealists, or there were idealists. So I mean idealists in the sense of adherence of idealistic philosophy. And McTaggart is one of them. So there's no discussion about 1908 being later than 1905. And so he could have known about Einstein, but he didn't know. So this is a discussion in a completely different quarter of the intellectual world. So let's go on. Well, perhaps making... So now I'm reminded of idealistic philosophy. And so I'm reminded of another argument, also with the conclusion that time does not exist, which comes from a physicist, and it's in a way is reminiscent of this argument. I'm thinking of, no, not a physicist, a mathematician, a logician, Kurt Gödel, well known here, who in his later days became interested also in general relativity and found the solution of the Einstein field equations around 1949. And so he published, so this is the famous Gödel solution in which you have closed time-like loops. So that seems to make it possible to travel in time. So you go along the loop and come back into your own past. And he published this as a physical result in the Physical Review, I think, famous physics journal. But then he also wrote a philosophical article about that, and that has appeared in the in the volume Einstein, Philosopher, Scientist. So it's a book in which several authors respond to things Einstein had done, and Einstein in the later part of the book responds to all these articles. And Gödel also contributed to this volume with an article. I don't remember the precise title, but it's something like the relation between general relativity and idealistic philosophy. And in that article, he also argues that time does not exist according to general relativity. And the argument is a little bit like this, because he says if you on such a closed timeline loop, well, it will be impossible that time progresses and flows all the way in the linear way we are used to from experience. And if this lapse, so he calls this the lapse of time, so if this flow is not there, well, then it doesn't make sense to speak about time at all. It's also a controversial argument, because you could object that this conclusion only follows in the quite specific case of this one solution of the Einstein field equations, and to go from that possible world to our own world, that's a second that has been much criticized in the modern literature. But the spirit of the proof and the argument is the same as the McTaggart thing. It's completely independent, by the way. So we have seen that in experiential time, there are these characteristics of flow common now, and if you think of it, then there are questions, issues about that. Now let's turn to the way time is used in physics. So just look at the theories we have. Some classical mechanics, special relativity, also general relativity. General relativity is a bit more complicated, so let's focus on classical mechanics and special relativity. What we find there is a four-dimensional manifold of points in which events are located. And there is no preferred now. I have a picture in a moment which I'll show you. All the events are there in a big block-like representation, and there is no preferred slice about which you could say this is the present, this is the now. So I've yeah, let me go over this. So here we have a picture of this. I'm focusing on special relativity right away, so classical space-time is almost the same, the little differences concerning the geometrical structure, but the general idea is the same. So in this representation, we have to imagine that all events that actually occur in the history of the universe are represented. They are there. So we are sitting here, and Napoleon was moving around in Europe in 1815 here, and then some other place there, Aristotle was lecturing in Athens. And well, each event is unique. So that's coming back to your question. It has its own position in the picture, namely exactly position in which it actually occurs. And that brings me to a second point. Very often, this kind of picture is commented upon in the following way, as I did actually a moment ago. People say there is no now in this picture. But actually, that's a mistake. The thing is full of nows. Because every event here is its own now. So it's not a scarcity of now that we are confronting here, but it's an abundance of now.
Can I make an observation?
No, yes.
I suppose this T has the years, right? The 18, 19, blah, blah, and the places.
So the places are on the X, yeah?
Yes, so there's on the X-axis there happened to be Paris, and on the T-axis there happened to be 2017.
Yes.
So there is one now there, I see it.
No. So each moment, so when Aristotle was lecturing in Athens,
sure.
He said, it's now, and that now is there.
Yes, but I can use the word now, and I see that.
Yeah, and it's there. I haven't drawn you there, but if I had, you would be there saying now. Now is now.
I would.
Yeah, but there's no preferred now. So we, of course, we agree on this point. So there's no preferred now. But all these events here represent a now in another sense, namely the now of the moment itself, the moment of occurrence, the instant of occurrence.
But would you agree that I can say, without saying anything stupid, I look at my watch, where I see where I am, and I see the now is there. The here now is there. My here now, I'm talking to you, so...
Yeah, but exactly... But exactly
perfectly sense to
but exactly this event, that you make this statement, and looking at your watch and things like that, that's in the picture.
And there are already several nows because you repeated that.
Yeah. So there's a lot of. So it's a whole word line, and at each point in this word line, you are shouting, "It's now!" And it's all there. No, but I, of course, I understand what you're saying. So what we intuitively would expect, and that's the idea of the A series, is that there is some special now with a little star on it. This is the real now, and that it shifts up. So that's what you're saying. So part of what I will be saying is that we don't need that. That we can understand everything that we feel and experience without having something additional to the picture of that kind. And I would also say already now that in physics, we or you don't need it. So the only thing you really need is the picture as I have it here. But let's keep that perhaps for discussion. So this is a representation of what is called the block universe, and because the whole history of the universe is here represented as one thing in its entirety, so a block that's there. And I'm afraid the block universe has a bad name. It has a bad reputation. It's associated with block-headedness, lack of flexibility and things like that. And I think there are a lot of misunderstandings about this block universe. So one of them I already mentioned, namely that there is no now in it, so I think that there's plenty of now in the block universe. Another thing is that people very often think that the block universe entails something about determinism. So that also comes from a comparison with our intuitive notion of time. So we have this idea that the future is open and in a way is inaccessible to it, it doesn't exist. And if I make a picture in which the future is already there, as people sometimes say, it seems that I am in conflict with that. And that can only be true if there is some kind of determinism in the universe. So there are many articles, also in the philosophical literature, that say that the block universe doesn't make sense in indeterministic theories. But that's all, as far as I can see at least, that's all complete nonsense. Because whether or not our theories are deterministic or indeterministic, you can draw this block universe picture anyway. So suppose that one of the events is a radioactive atom has decayed at a certain time. Well, that event, it has decayed, is of course represented in the block universe. And that's completely so what actually occurs is there. And that's completely independent of the conditions. I mean, the theoretical description by means of laws and whether or not these laws are deterministic or not. So I would say that it's a very innocent picture. It's very light from a metaphysical point of view. It doesn't presuppose any heavy stuff about determinism, fixedness of things. It's just the things as they actually occur. And the only condition that has to be satisfied in order for me to be able to draw such a picture is that there is a unique history of the world. And then I just record it. Well, and it's all about, not about my knowledge, but in principle it exists. It's a mathematical fact that there is this set of events, and that's represented here.
Do you have a better name than Block Universe that you can propose?
Well, it's a four-dimensional picture, but so the usual way of discussing this is in terms of the block, but so perhaps it would be a good idea to have an alternative name, because it has all kinds of bad connotations. I agree with that. But in principle, this is the same as having the schedule of the railways. And so it already has that tomorrow the train will leave at a certain point of time. And no one will say, oh, that's a matter of fixedness of the future. Well, there's a difference, because you cannot trust the railways schedule.
So Minkowski called it the world, with a capital W.
Yeah, that's true.
Welt, that's his name, the proper name.
Because Minkowski called it that way.
It's didn't call it the Block Universe?
No, that's true. So the world, that would be fine.
Who called it the Block Universe first?
It comes from James, actually. Bradley, he took it from Bradley, who meant it in a positive way, and in a derogatory way. William James referred to those who believe in a Block Universe that does not evolve or flow.
Yeah. Well, let me go on. So there is some structure, of course, in this universe. So I've drawn here this. So I've indicated here that there is a four-dimensional distance between any two events. So this is special relativity, Minkowski space-time. But you could do the same with the classical Newtonian space-time. Then things become, from a mathematical point of view, a little bit more complicated, because then there is absolute simultaneity. And so between any two points, there are two distances, a temporal distance and a spatial distance. But because, classical mechanics is far behind us, so let's focus on relativity. So there's a certain geometrical structure there. And that has certain consequences for the temporal aspects. Instead of one temporal distance between two events, it depends on the path you take, and that's what they call, in some literature, this is called many-fingered times. It's like when you go along, so your fingers would be an example, along different ways to the same event, and then you get different temporal intervals. So the structure of time is different, and it's the time interval between any two points is determined once you indicate the curve along which you go, and then you have to integrate this line element. And that's what occurs in the physical laws. This quantity occurs in the physical laws. So here's another picture to make the same thing clear. So you have world lines, those indicate the history of a point, but I idealized also a person, if it's small enough. And the time, the time interval between these two points A and B is given by this integral. And all the things like a twin paradox and so on, it's not really a paradox, it's a twin effect, is contained in this picture. So if you go from point A to point B along different pathways, you will that will be connected in general, at least, with different time intervals, and so if you have two twin brothers, then they need not to have the same age when they come together again here in B. And already that, of course, is in conflict with strong intuitions that we have. So I remember once giving a popular lecture about special relativity and the twin effect, and there was an enormous protest from the audience, because they thought it was unjust that two twin brothers who were born at the same time could and live in similar circumstances could end up having different ages, because it's almost the definition of a twin to have the same age. So but even for people who know a lot about relativity theory, it's sometimes it's hard to fully accept these things. especially if you you're not a professional physicist, of course. So, but what this also illustrates, this twin effect, is that there is a definite structure in this Minkowski spacetime. And for the, in the case of the twin brothers, the difference between the two, of course, is given by their different relation to the inertial structure in Minkowski spacetime. So, so this Minkowski spacetime is a thing with properties. So these are the original notes of the 1908 lecture about space and time by Minkowski, in which he discusses this structure characterized by the hyperbolas and the contraction and things like that. And well, this gives me the opportunity to address a question, well, which I already mentioned in the beginning. Does time exist according to special relativity? Well, I would say, apparently, yes, it does exist, but it has completely different properties than what we are used to in everyday experience. So there is this structure in space-time, it has consequences for the temporal order, and well, this Minkowski space-time is just something that's there. It could be even there, in, according to special relativity, if there are no material events at all. So it's something that exists independently. Now, sometimes we hear arguments of the following kind. That so let me give you an example. When we discuss time, what we actually mean, that's what people say, is what we read off from a clock. And so all this speaking about time is actually just speaking about clocks. And therefore, time in itself does not exist. What does exist are these clock readings. But I think that's a very bad argument, because it confuses epistemological and ontological aspects of the matter. The clocks, of course, are used to measure the time, but there is something behind the behavior of the clock that explains why all clocks have certain temporal, have certain relations in their indications. And that thing that's there in the background, that's exactly the structure of Minkowski spacetime. And so I would say that this structure of Minkowski spacetime and its independence really shows you that the time exists in special relativity.
I had never noticed that the title of the transparency is the contraction of the electron.
Yeah.
It's not about clocks, or it's about the...
Yeah, but that relates to the discussion we had in the train yesterday.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
But still we would not cite Poincaré.
No. So, but this matter of the structure of the electron and how it is able to contract, that was a living issue in those
Are the models original, or you added them?
I think this is the original, so I didn't draw it. but this is the original.
It's in black and white, I've never seen the colors.
No, I think the colors are original.
I think Scott Walter from Nancy, he has dig out transparencies.
I know, but I never
and with,
seen
and he, with
the
these
colors.
Colors.
With the
with
colors,
colors.
Okay.
I think it's
what I learned from him.
So who was that?
Scott Walter.
Oh, Scott Walter, yeah.
In Nancy.
Yes. I think it's original. And so the matter of the contraction of the electrons, that oh, sorry.
Don't worry.
Yeah, it has to do with the right-hand part of the picture in which of this contract.
When you say time exists now, you use it time in the same sense in which you said time don't exist after MacTaggart, or you're using time in a different sense?
MacTaggart said time doesn't exist.
Right, so now you say time exists.
And I say time does exist, but I mean something different from what MacTaggart said.
So you're using time in different meanings here.
So that's a very good remark, so I should be very careful, of course. So what I'm saying is that in order to be justified to say that time exists, you don't need the now and the flowing now aspect. So yeah, to give a more direct answer to what you were saying, the time that exists, according to this argument here, is the time which would be in agreement with MacTaggart's B. Serious. But he says that that's not time.
Right.
And I'm going to say that it is time.
Right. Okay.
Yeah, because it's able to explain everything we feel and experience, and it's sufficient.
Is it a grammatical discussion about what, how do we want to use a word, or is it discussion?
No, I think there's more to it. So, as I said a moment ago, I think that if we base ourselves on this notion of time, so the block universe idea of time, or the B-series idea of time, that gives us a sufficient tool to understand how what we feel, and even, as I will briefly indicate in the sequel, even we may be able to explain this idea of flow. So let's go on a little bit. So how much? But if you start at
so started at 20 to 10.
So I've used 35 minutes or something.
Just 40 minutes.
40 minutes, okay. So the first point of attention here just repeats what I already said, that in special relativity, space-time exists independently. Well, general relativity adds new things to the picture, but the most important thing, I think, is that space-time becomes dynamical. But it still is there as something that's independent of, so the thing of the GMU field, the medical field, it's still there as something that's independent of what usually is called the material content of the universe. And what's more, many of the things that I said in the context of special relativity will also apply to general relativity, because if you confine, restrict yourself to small portions of space-time, well, special relativity will apply, and all these things about the different path to between two points and different notions of simultaneity, I will discuss that in a moment, will still apply even in the context of general relativity. So let me not focus too much on general relativity here. But let's go to the question of simultaneity, because that's important for this common notion that we have, that we're all part of one and the same now. Now, if you look a little bit better, more in detail, at this structure that special relativity gives us, and which also applies to general relativity in the small, then we, well, as we all know, of course, then we have these, from every point there's emanating light going in this direction and light going in that direction, so incoming light signals here and outgoing ones there. And then usually what one takes as simultaneity is this plane, which is actually space at the time. So it's, of course, the number of dimensions has been suppressed here. This is orthogonal to the orthogonal in the Minkowski sense to this world line that I have here. And now in the philosophy of physics, and also in physics itself, there's a lot of discussion about the exact status of this plane of simultaneity. And many people say that simultaneity, relativistic simultaneity, is conventional. And it's also one of these discussions that has been raging for a long time, and there's no completely convincing conclusion. So this all starts with a remark Einstein made in his 1905 paper, where he discusses the synchronization of clocks, and so by sending light signals from one clock to another synchronizing them on the basis of the results. And then he makes the remark that we can do this in this way, synchronizing the clocks in this way, when we stipulate that the velocity of light is the same in both directions. And I think he uses the word feststellung in a convention. That it's a convention in to do so, and that you could do it in different ways. And so, what would that mean? That instead of this hyperplane that's orthogonal to the world line, you could have tilted hyperplanes, which would also function all right as a definition of simultaneity. So mind you, what I'm discussing here is not simultaneity from different frames of reference, because then it's generally accepted that different observers will assigned different notions of simultaneity to the events. But what I'm discussing here is all within one frame of reference, an usual frame of reference, and even there the plane of simultaneity can be taken in different ways. So that's an ongoing discussion. Well, it has become a little bit old-fashioned to bother about this, I think, but still there's no real conclusion. But for us here, I think it's not so important. What for us here is important is that however, in whatever way you take this definition of simultaneity, it will always be the case that the points that you take as being simultaneous with your own position are at space-like separation, and that means that they cannot influence you. And that's very important for our discussion of this common now, because if you think that what we feel and experience is all conditioned by the signals that we receive and that reach us and are processed in our brain, then you immediately see that this notion of simultaneity as it is used in physics is of no importance for that. Because these events that are taken, which events you take as simultaneous with your own position, doesn't matter at all for what's going on in your own head, in your brain, in your perceptions. So that's why I focus a bit on this simultaneity question. So so this whole discussion about the state of simultaneity is, I think, not important for understanding how our perception works. And in general relativity, so I repeat the remark I made a moment ago, it's not really different. Some people think that the notion of a global now and a shifting now has a better chance of survival in general relativity than in special relativity, because there are certain solutions of the Einstein field equations which have a global foliation. But again, I think this is a misunderstanding, because for our perception of time and for our notion of flow and common now, this foliation is of no importance at all, because they will always be foliations without any causal relevance for our perception. So let me go over that also in view of the time that's passing quickly. So now I come to my third point. I would say that this physical picture of time, so where we have the block universe developed, the world, is sufficient for us. And that actually it's better than the time concept that we derive from an immediate experience. It's more fundamental. And that our daily life experience is deceptive in many ways. Actually, and for part this may be controversial, but I think it's also partly general accepted. I think it's generally accepted that in fact we are not in contact with others, if you think of it in the way that intuition supposes, namely that it's a kind of immediate contact. In reality, signals take some time to come to us. And so I will say more about that in a moment. So I think it's there are certain aspects of our common intuitions which are deceptive, and in certain aspects even are deceptive in an uncontroversial way. Then there are other aspects of our perception that, well, can be made subject to experimental research, and there's a whole field nowadays of time perception. So that's in sensory physiology and neurophysiology, which have revealed certain aspects of the way our brain and our perception works that are really quite spectacular in some respects. And one of the things, well, that's not really a recent thing, it's connected actually with Billy James already and with Peter Sessions of him, is that this feeling that we have of a now, if you analyze it, is not really a point in time, if you compare it to the physical description, but it comprises a finite interval in physical time. And the name, it's not really introduced by James, but it was made popular by William James, is that of the specious present, so that's an extended present. I will say some more about that in a moment. And then my third point that I want to address is that so the first two points are about the defectiveness of our experience of time, the concepts we derive from that. And the third point is that time as it is used in physics is actually sufficient to explain how our sensory perception works. So let me go on. So I already mentioned this a number of times. So there is this idea of a common now, that we have contact with others in one shared, spatially extended now. But as I already have argued, if you look at the physics, and also, so if you look at common sense, if you think about it, about the speed of signals, then that cannot be the case, because signals, light, takes a certain time to reach me. So I can only look into the past. And so if I see you here, actually, so my first impression is that you are here now, but actually you are not here now. Not for me, at least. It's, well, Carlo is there in his now, but it's my past. But physics can explain why we think, why we think so in ordinary, why this idea of a common now is so pervasive and so persistent. And that's because of the enormously high value of the velocity of light. So the time it takes for a signal to get from you to me, well, that's minute. So it doesn't take any time at all, you could say. Hardly any time. Now, still, it would be detectable that there is this time lapse between the emission of a signal and the reception at my sensory apparatus. But that could only be if there are certain processes of change that are comparable in the variability with the speed of light, the change in the time that's needed for a signal to get from you to me. And most processes that we encounter, all processes that we encounter in daily life are not of that kind. So things change very slowly compared to the time it takes for light to go from you to me. And that's why it's very easy for me to maintain that this is all happening at the same time. So what I see that's happening at the same time is my own feelings. So this is an example of where physics gives you a better picture of what's going on and can explain what you are feeling. So this notion of a common now is perfectly explained by physics. And I think that's the general line to follow, that if you base yourself on the physical description of the situation, then you will be able to explain and to understand exactly what's happening in your brain. And I think this is an uncontroversial example of that. But given that we have this example, there is reason to doubt also our other intuitions. Now we can explain that, expand that a little bit. So we can model, if you want to give this physical explanation, we can model an observer by a time-like world line. And the perception at any point on this world line is independent of what happens simultaneously with you. So any global now that could be supposed to be is irrelevant for our time perception. And so I repeated the point that I made before, that also the idea that in general relativity it makes the difference whether the space-time is can be foliated or not is completely irrelevant for our conception of a common now. So it doesn't play any explanatory role. So let me go to the second point. So that's a result. Well, it was this species present, which was introduced more or less by James, but it has been the subject of experimental results now for many decades. it turns out, and you can just investigate this in the laboratory, that what we consider to be at the same moment actually combines impressions from different points in physical times. And so there have been countless experiments, typically with students who sit in front of a computer and look at the screen, and then they are confronted with signals which objectively take place at different points in time. And then the students are asked to push a button when two things are happening at the same time or not. And then it turns out that they combine signals from very different times. So the subjective present has a certain thickness, a certain elongation amongst the world line, a certain length. So that's an empirical point. And now that gives us a handle, I think. Well, it's not only I who think so, but many people think so. That gives us a handle for explaining how it's possible that we feel that time moves. And I want you to look at the following picture. So what do you see? Most people see motion here. But actually, there is no motion, and so this is not any explanation of the flow of time. So let me make that clear. But it gives a direction of the kind of explanations that have been given. So this species present extends a little bit along the world line of a person. There are different elements of sensory content within that present, and it seems to be the case, as shown in this picture, that if your brain is confronted with something which has different aspects, then it's inclined to respond by a dynamical response. So it gives you the impression of something dynamical that's happening, whereas there's no dynamism in this. In this picture, this is not the whole story, so it's just a kind of suggestion that there may be. Well, I think most people working in the neurophysiology and sensory physiology take this route. There's a lot of recent literature about these things, and if you're interested in the details, I will be happy to give you that. So this is the general picture that we have. There is no, according to physics, so that's a physical account of all these things. So there is no common now, but there is light and other signals coming in. So the faster signals, of course, have the speed of light. So that's the light cone that I've drawn in here. Here is the world line of an observer. And here's this extended present, the species present, in which there are different aspects combined. And so the line of the physical explanation that's taken is that this species present is connected, so our brain responds to that with a feeling of flow. There are more things to be said about this. I will mention a couple of things in the next slide. But an important point that I want to make clear, which harks back to some of the things that were mentioned earlier here, is that this picture applies tenselessly. So you can exactly the same explanation can be given for all the points along the world line, and so it doesn't presuppose any preferred now along our whole world line as existing beings, as conscious beings. We say it's now, and we feel this flow at all points because exactly the same story applies now. There is more to be said about this, and the direction that research in neurophysiology, which is not really my specialty, the direction which this takes involves the following ingredients. So what's also important for a complete understanding of how we react to our surroundings is asymmetry, physical asymmetry. But as I mentioned in the very beginning of my talk, you should sharply distinguish asymmetry from flow. So you can think about asymmetry of the universe with think of the growth of entropy. You can think of that without involving any notion of the flow of time. But it's important for the picture I just sketched, because on the basis of these asymmetries, for instance, you can understand, it's a whole story in itself, you can understand why it's relatively easy for us to acquire knowledge about the past, and it's much more difficult to say something about the future. And that's because, that goes together with the growth of entropy. The ages of things happen in one direction, are formed in one direction of time, and much less so in the other direction. So for instance, a bomb explodes, that goes together with the growth of entropy. It leaves traces everywhere, and you find a little piece, remnant of the original thing, and you can confirm by finding a little thing a little bit further away, that this must be coming from this one point. And the opposite thing, that for instance radiation converges to one point, that's apparently not so. So that's a whole topic in itself, why this is so. Most people think this is just a matter of initial and boundary conditions, the past hypothesis that was mentioned in one of the talks. So, but that's an ingredient of a full explanation of how we respond to our environment. And another important point is that, how evolution has made us fit to survive in these surroundings. And how we make use of the asymmetries and the notion of causality, how we can act as a causal agent, that's also important. But that, take me too far afield to go into a discussion of these things. I just want to indicate the line of research that's being taken in this field. And the most important thing is what I have here in both phases, that all these explanations only make use of physical time without any preferred now. And so there are all prospects that it will be possible, and I think most people believe that it is possible, that to use physical time as the basis and completely understand what's going on in the time of perception. So important is that our feeling of now is the way our brain represents to us difference in perceptual content during the species present. So that doesn't mean that we have to say that flow is an illusion. So yeah, that's why I put this objective here. So there's an objective state of affairs that's represented by our response in terms of flow. And this objective state of affairs, that's the temporal order, as it is given, for instance, in Minkowski spacetime or in more general spacetime. So the temporal order between the events, that's something that's there independently of us. And we represent that in a certain way to ourselves, from our own point of view within this big world picture, the block universe. And so I do not. So it's a bit of semantical thing, perhaps. But I do not agree completely with the idea that the flow of time is just an illusion. I would rather say it's our way of representing what the objective order is.
But your slide that you showed
had illusion on it.
It's called an optical illusion.
Oh, is that so? Then I'm well, I change my mind all the time, so let me see.
The motion is just called this way. That's a normal way of calling these things.
The blue dots, you show.
The blue dots.
The blue dots.
I just say, in normal language, you say this is an optical illusion.
Not that one.
Nothing moves.
Oh,
the blue dots.
Oh, this one. Oh,
it's just called an optical illusion, and you are telling us that our sense of flow is of the same type, not made by this. So we can still call it illusion. It's just.
Well, if you insist.
Go on. I did not want to interrupt.
No. So this is an interesting point.
I would call it illusion. sense of flow.
Well, yeah, well, but there is something that's at the basis of this illusion.
Sure, sure. And something objective.
I think there are differences between the temporal picture.
All illusions are based on something objective.
It's an interesting point. I'm wavering a little bit myself. So one day I think you better call this an illusion. Other day I think, well, not. There's something to it. I mean, there is this order in the universe. But yeah, but you understand.
Yes, I want to say that this illusion of motion depends, however, on time, because you look at one second and then next second you see, without time it doesn't work.
So I didn't present it as the real explanation. So what I said is that this gives you a kind of handle of on the type of explanations that are being given. And so the idea I wanted to make clear, but I sympathize with what you say, is that it seems to be the case that our brain is responding in certain circumstances in which there is no motion, and still we project that into it. But that's a valid criticism. So let me go on. So perhaps I shouldn't dwell too long on this aspect. So what I'm saying is that ordinary physics is able to explain. There is no reason to doubt that ordinary physics is able to explain our experience of time. But in philosophy, people very often, some philosophers take the position that the A theory, in which there is this flow of time, is always, whatever the result of the deliberations of the kind I have given are, that the A theory always is in a better position to explain our sensory experience. Because if there is objective flow in the world, well, then it stands to reason that we feel objective flow. That's the idea. Which I think is wrong, because I can't see, even if there were objective flow in the universe, I can't see how we would be sensitive to it, knowing what we know about how our brain works and how things are described by the physics of the situation. So I'm looking a little bit at the explanatory resources of the A theory. Well, the first problem, I already dwelt on that a little bit, is what meaning can be given to objective flow. So that's something problematic. And the second problem is that even if we skip that problem and think that in some way it's possible to avoid all terms, then the concepts that we have to introduce do not play any role. So the additional concepts that we have to introduce do not play any role in the explanations that we give, not in the scientific explanations at least. And to give you just an example, so what people have proposed to avoid these McTaggart conclusions is that we need a super time. So we have time, but there's also an additional super time with a big capital S. And then the idea of flow becomes understandable, because the now in ordinary time can have different positions depending on the value of super time, and then you can introduce a flow as d small t over d big t, so the differential coefficient that I have here. And another way to actually to give expression to the same kind of idea is to introduce what they call primitive tenses. So it's the same idea of introducing something additional in order to make sense of this notion of shift of time, which you cannot do within ordinary physics. But the problem with all these things is that these additional concepts do not play a role in physical theory. And as far as we know, all the whole sensory process and our feelings can, so we don't have to think of ourselves, think of the experiments that are done in the laboratory, even with flies, little insects and so on. As far as we know, physics is sufficient to completely understand everything that that happens there. So it seems that there is no explanatory achievement made by these new concepts that are introduced. So we have additional wheels here in explanations, but there is no added empirical content. And it seems that the only function of these attempts is to tell a story that's very pleasing to the intuition. But we have seen that intuition is not to be trusted in this context. So this common now, I think, is the prime example where we cannot trust our intuition. Intuition by temporal things. So I think this more or less rebuts statements like the following that I've taken from the literature. So the first challenge is that the pensless theory, so that's the block theories, cannot explain why time appears to flow. Well, we have seen that's highly debatable, controversial. I think the block theory is able to say something about that. But then this second thing, that even if the tensor theorist can discharge his obligation, so given his explanation, the doubt remains that the tensed theorist, so the one who thinks that there is really objective flow, can produce a simpler explanation of our experience. I think that's just wrong, because the explanation that's given by the tensed theorist must be much more complicated, actually, than the explanation given by the tenseless theorist. Actually, we do not know how such an explanation would work, because as far as we know, we don't have an antenna in our heads for these primitive tenses of super time or things like that. Everything we know about how organisms function can be described in ordinary physical terms. So yeah. Well, I have to keep an eye on the time.
It does not exist.
It doesn't exist, but nevertheless. Yeah, well, it exists! I said that until now it exists. Until now. But in quantum theory, quantum gravity theory, things become a little bit different and obscure. And, well, we all know that there have been lots of statements, claims, that time might not exist in quantum gravity, but the opposite claim has also been made, and that's in causal set theory. I'm not going to dwell on that for a long time, but so people like Faye Dauker and Sorkin and what's the other, well, Smolin, they say, there's a theory underlying generativity, a quantum gravity theory, in which the primitive concepts are events that are connected by causal bonds, and these are asymmetric relations between the events. And the way they talk about that is that this makes it possible to understand from an objective physical point of view what it means for time to flow, because events come into being, so they are born as a result of these causal influences. But I think that's just a confusion, because what we have here, what's introduced in this theoretical framework, is an asymmetrical relation between events. But as we have seen, asymmetry doesn't imply anything about flow. That's what I said in the very beginning. So I think this is a conceptual failure from the very start. Much more interesting, I think, is the second horn of the dilemma. So I'm not going to say much about this. We can come back to this in the discussion if needed. But I think much more interesting than this is the second horn of the dilemma. If you look at canonical quantum gravity and all its variations, quantum loop gravity and things like that, then we meet this well-known problem of time. So what we have there is an equation. So if you try to quantize general relativity, this is an equation, but it doesn't involve time. It's an equation on spatial geometry. So this Wheeler-DeWitt equation that I've written down here, it's a kind of constraint equation on spatial geometries, and it doesn't involve any time. And so it seems that the whole status of the concept of time becomes problematic there. Still, of course, in some limiting situation, in a limit, we should be able to retrieve time as it functions in our ordinary theories. So there have been made many suggestions about how a kind of internal time should be reconstructible from the timeless picture of the Biot-de-Witt equation. And one of the proposals that have been made, and I explained a little bit here, not as a kind of definitive solution to these things, but as a kind of model of how these explanations go. One of the proposals has been developed to quite some extent in this context by Klaus Schiever and others, and it takes its clue from an old paper by Neville Mott from the 30s, and it's let's directly go to the case itself. It's about the following situation. So we have an electron, that's the black blob here, that's bound to a center here. So think of it as an atom, one electron atom. And then there's a more massive particle passing by. It's in the paper by Mott in 1931, it's an alpha particle that goes by there. And now there are several ways of treating this problem quantum mechanically. And the first one, an obvious one, so we are interested, let's say, in the probability that this system will become excited. Well, the obvious way of approaching this question is to write down a time-dependent Schrödinger equation for this system, that's for the electron, in which this H sub A is the Hamiltonian of this system, and this V here is an external potential which gives the attraction between the electron here and the alpha particle here. And in this treatment, this alpha particle is treated as something external. So it's not quantized, only the electron or the atom, you could say, is quantized, and there we have the time-dependent Schrödinger equation. And of course, time is presupposed here because it's here in the equation, so it's the derivative with respect to time. But now there's another way, and that's shown by Mott in this article, to treat the same situation, and that turns out to be more or less equivalent, and that is to treat the whole system as a quantum system, and in a time-independent way. So I write down the time-independent Schrödinger equation, so just the Eigen equation for energy here. Now it turns, so there's no time here. No time at all. So the variables that occur in this total Hamiltonian are just the position of this thing here, the position of this thing here, there's no time. And now it turns out, under certain conditions, that you can derive from this equation here, let's look for the electron, so it's a kind of effective equation for the electron, and it looks exactly like the equation that I have there, but now instead of this time, I have the derivative with respect to the position of this alpha particle. And so what this suggests is that in this timeless picture, that's of the bottom half of my slide here, a kind of effective time emerges as the indication of in which this alpha particle functions as a kind of clock. So instead of time, I now have quantities that pertain to this system here. So it's a kind of effective time. So that's one observation, that time comes out of this in a kind of disguised form. But then there's a second important remark to be made, and that is that this only holds in certain circumstances. Not in general. If you make certain assumptions about the effective state of this alpha particle, and what it boils down to is that this alpha particle must have an approximately well-defined velocity or momentum, and also because and its mass is enormously great, so it's a big mass, and so its position is also more or less well-defined, and in those circumstances, well, you can treat this alpha particle as a thing that has this velocity, so its position is velocity times the time, that the ordinary time, and so time pops out of this under these conditions as set defined by phi, but that can only be done under quite specific conditions. And so what does that mean? Well, we have, I think here for the, so this is a kind of model, also of more general and other ways of approaching the question. So this is all about approaches to make time emerge. And so that means that it seems to be the case that it's possible to make time come out of situations in which, well, at the basic level, time is not present, and this will only work in quite specific circumstances and as a kind of approximation. So that's why I speak about emergence here, and so the definition of emergence that I use, it's similar to what Sebastian de Haro used yesterday, is that on a certain level of organization you encounter new behavior and new quantities of a robust character, but this is all via approximations, and so in that sense the thing that emerges is not fundamental. It comes out of something that's more fundamental and that has different properties. And I think that may be the first situation in which you could say that time does not exist, perhaps might not exist. I'm hesitant about this as well as in the case of the illusions, because even in this more fundamental level, there must be some order, and time comes, so this emerging time comes out as a kind of reflection of this underlying order, so the temporal order comes out of this, and to say that there is no time at all, it's a point of discussion, I would say. So I'm coming to the end of my talk, so... So I forgot to mention this. One thing I think we can conclude from this, so I'm uncertain about whether time exists or not, but I'm quite certain that this reinforces the idea that there is no flow in reality, because time is here replaced by things like position and momentum and other quantities, and no one has ever suggested that in those quantities there is any flow. So if time emerges in the way sketched here, I think that's a sure sign that flow is not something objective, it's just something that happens in our perception. So it reinforces the earlier argument. So that's my conclusion, finally. So I think that already in classical physics, the notion of time flow as an objective thing appearing in reality is conceptually problematic. And we have seen that in some cases it's patent that our time intuition is deceptive, and this, I would say, casts doubt on the value of our temporal intuition in general. For explanatory purposes, we do not need these additional concepts, flow and common noun, things like that. And if anything, I think the situation concerning quantum gravity is a little bit uncertain and unclear, but if anything, I think then the results of quantum gravity research reinforce this, the idea that flow is not an objective thing. I'm not quite sure about the existence of time. So let me stop at that point.
I fundamentally agree with everything you said.
That's really
I mean, I have two comments. One, it's simpler and it's more terminological than substantial, but I think it's a source of endless confusion. And the second is more substantial. The simple one is that you use heavily deceptive, specious, illusory, objective versus perceptual, which, in my opinion, create misunderstanding. And in fact, you yourself at some point waffle about that. For instance, when Thibault points out, well, by illusion we mean so and so.
Yeah.
So a point made by a number of people, and Mauro Dorato is one of them, is that to say that some of our intuitions do not reflect the fundamental structure of the world is something that physicists can serenely and happily say, but if this is framed in the form that's illusory, it goes against what you yourself say in a later step, which is that illusion can perhaps be understood in terms of approximation, in terms of something else, and so on. So I just wanted to make this
point. Yeah, I found it a difficult subject. So, but it's similar to, if I may comment on what you said?
Sure.
It's similar like the introduction of other indexical or perspectival things. So for instance, I'm saying I'm standing here. That's not an illusion. I'm really standing here.
That is, let me go to the second point.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Two together. Here I was not referring to that, just to the fact that up and down are illusory or not. Well, they're not illusory, but they are not in Newton equations.
Yes.
And we don't have problems with that.
Yeah, okay.
Now, let me come to the second problem, which is about indexicals. That's the second comment. And the comment is this. I found, I just want to advertise a book written by a philosopher, Jenan Ismael. The title of the book is A Situated Self, that makes an argument. Sometimes my physicist friend asked, what do you learn from philosophy? Well, that's nothing. It makes an argument that I found very good. So let me just briefly remind the argument. Take a map, like the map of the world that you sketched with time and space. Now, I don't believe there's anything outside the world. I'm a naturalist, and I think that the world as described by physics includes essentially everything, maybe sketchy, but everything. So in particular, I can ask, where the hell is that map? This map is not outside the world, written in the mind of God, or written in a parallel world. This map happened to be on a piece of paper, on a slide, on a computer. So even if it doesn't have a mark, any map which is not partial, but is global enough to pretend to represent the world, by the very fact of its existence, somewhere, at some time, has on it, implicitly or non-implicitly, a mark that says, I the map, I'm here. Now this is a fact. It's an undeniable fact. It doesn't contradict the fact that the map itself is a good representation of the world, but if the map is a good representation of the world, it includes also where the map is.
Where the map itself is?
Yes. Yeah. Of course, because...
Because it's in the world, it's somewhere.
So, this doesn't contradict the fact that the map has everything to say, but I think it gives us a tool to understand, to help us understanding what we mean when we use indexicals, like now, here, me, and so on.
Yeah.
So, through that, through the fact that the image of the block universe always makes sense, but in anything we say, including what the map says itself, it's always something which is situated. We have a picture of the world which is only from within. I think we can understand better what is our notion of here, local now, and not try to conceptualize it as illusory, but conceptualize it with what it is, which is indexicals.
Yes. No, I think I agree with you. I didn't completely understand the piece about the map, but I understand the drift of what you're saying, and I think he also agrees. So, in indexical terms, are terms that refer to one who makes the utterance. So, for instance, here and there. So I'm here, but you are at your own here. And so, in a sense, here is not objective, but still, it's not illusory. We are at the own point. We both are justified in saying that we're here. So I don't have yet the book by Ismail, but I've seen some of her work. And actually, she gave a presentation in Tarquinia a couple of months ago, which also touched upon these things. And so this may be also a point of discussion between Yuval and myself. I think that the position that she defends is very close to what I'm saying here, and I would also say that it's very close to what in the literature is known as the B series point of view. And the usual way of putting it is that things like the now, like as the here, like the here, are indexical. And so we refer to our own point of view. And that was also in this picture that I had with the species present along the world line. From the point of this particular species present, there is this flow at that point. But she gives a kind of, she gives a new twist to the argument by speaking about the embedded self. Yeah, but I think it's more or less the same as saying that the things are indexical. So I speak from my own point of view, and indexical terms do not refer to illusions. They do not occur in the physical theory, but still they pertain to how we use the theory, or that perhaps relates to your map. And so I wouldn't, I think so we had this little discussion a moment ago. I don't think it's an illusion.
It's a point about you cannot separate what exists in the physical theory and we, because we exist in the physical theory. So you have an argument about the now is illusory. It's a response to this now is illusory.
So the now that we experience is in the physical picture. So that's what we had at the very beginning of the talk. All these nows are there. So they're certainly not illusory in that sense. They are represented, they're objectively there in the world picture. But perhaps a bit,
Yes, thank you for your defense of physical time, I think, on which we all agree.
Oh, that's a...
Yes. But I think the weak point...
A weak point?
No, your weak point. It's when you argue against the flow of time, the impression of flow of time we have. So I will mention some important points. In the beginning you said that the past doesn't exist, or the present exists. Then you introduce a word which is probably even more complicated than the notion of time. What means exists, you see? If you think really that the word it exists refers to a perception of time, you see, you cannot speak of a present exists or not if you have not a reference to something and actually to the actual present. You think, and so in the actual present. So the word exists is very, very complicated. Then also you said, it was Matt Taggart's argument that the event, you are here now, is exactly, and there was the word exactly the same in the past and in the present. Well, in my impression, it's certainly not exactly the same, because you say it was in the past and it is in the present, so that's the question. So in saying this, you suppose that past and present are the same. It's the same, it is in the past, it is in the present. So you say that, you suppose that past and present are the same. And then your conclusion, that time doesn't exist, is always already in the hypothesis.
You've presupposed the B series from the start.
No, I don't think so. Well,
okay, and then I come to the main point. Yes, the main point. Because you say that the physical time is sufficient.
Yes.
Well, we all agree again of that, and your defense was very conclusive. But, you see, you didn't say anything about the main question. How do you explain that we have this perception? You just said, oh, it's psychological, well...
Physiological, you said.
Physiological, yeah, okay, physiological. But,
so I did say some words about that.
Yes, but now if it is moreover physiological, yes, it happens in the brain. And in the brain, the perception of the present and a perception, a memory of the past, it's not the same. So in the brain you have material experience which distinguishes that this is pursued in the present. And this is in the past. If there were no difference, how come in our brains, which are material, there would be such a difference? And my opinion is that indeed physical time, and in a way time doesn't exist from the strictly physical time, but time is creation of consciousness. And consciousness, let's quote Berkeley, you see, there is no universe without the notion of consciousness. And time is creation of consciousness and not produced by the physical time.
No, thank you. Well, I think I did say a lot about the explanation of our perception of time flow. And so one of my arguments was, but I agree that I did not fully develop it, so he has indicated the direction that's being taken here, that the physical picture of time, in which there is no flow, is sufficient to explain this feeling of flow. And so I don't agree with you that I didn't address that topic. But when you say it's not, so you deny that this is sufficient. You say that there's something additional going on.
Because you don't explain why we feel this difference.
Yes.
You say it's physiological, well, the physiology,
yes.
It's material.
Yes.
So you have
Perhaps I now understand what you're saying. So you say everything that I say here is on the level of physical systems, a material description of systems, and what we feel is on a different level.
Yes.
So that goes back to the remark that was made in one of the earlier talks here about the qualia.
Because
our feelings and so are not of the kind of verbal position and momentum and things. But we feel
in the brain it's different. The past and the present is clearly different. If you analyze the brain,
I don't understand that point. Perhaps I'm not responding to what you say. So I'm not denying that there are differences in. From any point along your, so judged from any point along your world line between what's in the past and what's in the present. But that's a matter of asymmetry. And does it involve flow? So and it can be explained by physics on the basis of, for instance, the asymmetry of knowledge. There's a lot of literature about that, and that can be reduced to a matter about entropy growth. And this past hypothesis, which is much discussed in the present day literature. So David Albert has written a lot about it, and he makes, I think, a quite convincing case that, but he's not the only one, it's a long tradition. Reichenbach is also one of the people who has defended that. A long tradition of people who say that on the basis of these physical asymmetries you can understand that we know a lot about the past and that we have remembrances, recollections of the past, but not recollections of the future. So these things, I think, in principle can be understood. Well, what I understood that you were hinting at, but perhaps I misunderstand you, is that whatever I do within physics, I will never end up with a conclusion in which feelings or impressions, as we are familiar with them, are at the line of the conclusion. Because everything that goes in, all the premises are of a physical kind, and you don't get out something that's not physical. And that's a general problem, the mind-body relation, of course, and that has to do with this problem of the qualia, as they say, qualia. And, but that's a general problem, and so I must confess that in the background of all the things that I'm saying here is the conviction that a kind of naturalistic conviction that there is, well, perhaps not a reduction, but I don't know whether you're familiar with the term, but that there's a kind of supervenience of the mental on the physical. So that means that it's not possible that so there are different levels of discourse, and on one level, the level we are familiar with, we don't talk in terms of neurons and so on, but in terms of feelings, but we think they correspond with brain states. And it's not possible that the brain states become different without an accompanying difference on the ground level of the material, the substance that's there. So that's called supervenience, the idea of supervenience. And so I subscribe to that because it seems to be overwhelmingly supported by everything we know. Exactly how we have to explain the qualia, and so whether you can really reduce them to brain states, that's a contested subject. And so yeah, that's also, but perhaps I'm not really addressing what you.
Yes, you are, except that, of course, in the brain, the perception of the present and the perception of the
yeah, but the so that is one of the things that I forgot to mention in this list of ingredients that I have. So on the basis of evolutionary argument, you can also understand that our awareness is confined to a relatively short species present. So, because it would take, it's a rather technical story, it would take too much capacity if you could oversee our whole world line. And from an evolutionary perspective, it's sufficient to have a very small now. Yeah, well.
I think the coffee break ends in 5 minutes.
Oh, so then, yeah, sorry for taking up so much time.
So, maybe we can thank you.